Greetings. Welcome back to Pyre. Let's continue our journey toward the next right. Yonder lies the right reach of goal, somewhat less imposing when viewed from this vantage point. Do you not agree, reader? The myths on the downside hold that it is no mere ridge of stone, but the remains of Lord Grandorf, or slain but Goliathnian himself. Perhaps such tales are of little import now, when you stand to confront the withdrawn there in just a short while. You sense that Wulfred may gain a deeper understanding of the right along this route. Route looks clear, so you should have time to pursue your vocations. You make a successful landing in the Downside Prayer, near the southern edge of the Downside. Memories of having first met Hedwig, Dariel, and Ruki come flooding back. You now should have some time in the vicinity before continuing onward toward the reach of gold by land. Downside is connected to our realm via a single artery, the river named for our prestigious sub-colleague Lusclorian. That river gushes into seeming nothingness. That seeming nothingness turns out, of course, to be the downside. Its existence undermines thousands of years of thought about the composition of our world. The downside southern edge we call the Sandfalls. It is a desecrated wasteland speaking well to this land's lack of hospitality. Here, the strength of many who survived the river journey finally fails. If only they could clamber further north, where lies the verdant Downside Prayer, a better place to perish, to be sure. Yields fruit from time to time, though only if one says the magic words. You meet up with Bertrude, who suggested you grunging with her through Blooming Pool. You shall follow as the shadow in thy wake. Together, you set out to explore the rolling hills around the Black Wagon. You find little to speak of, other than desolation typical to the downside. The searching of this land yields not. Let us return. You are Bern and Bertrude make your way back to the wagon. Though uneventful, your search helped ease the burden weighted on you, and leaves you with time to pursue your vocations. Let us then discuss this matter, so which you believe should be of benefit. Bertrude gains a somewhat stronger grasp of how to better pass the celestial orb through strength of will and trust in one's triumvirate than through dexterity alone. She nods in understanding. This land is so rife with eldritch knowledge, long forbidden in the Commonwealth. We learn the stuff of fear itself. It appears that the dog knows something of the stars, then. After all. You approach Bertrude as she's finished polishing the various bottles, flasks, and vials that your fellow exiles have collected during your travels through the downside. The evidence of thy trials. How brazenly ye put them on display. Ye tempt these lands to swallow ye. She lets out a long breath. Nonetheless, this drink is dear our memories. Not merely of these lands, but of the country whence we came. No reading one that we are here because of Sandalwood. We met him long ago within the southern box. He offered many courtesies, and an exchange we found agreeable. We sold them to certain regions necessary to our studies of the heavens and the earth. And he knew where to procure them. In exchange, we were to boil for him our finest things. A certain receipt, notorious yet secret, its stain could never be removed. But the Commonwealth misliked it. It was when we first began collecting samples of the regions of the downside, for Sandalwood was ever true to his word. Long had we studied this accursed place, Black Basin, the chaos of the Devil's Tempest, the reaches of the Box of Lagging Hands, and so far away, and yet they called to us. If Molten Milif was able to traverse the downside in its entirety an age ago, then surely it was not beyond reckoning that we could do the same. But she hesitates. It matters not, reading one. Thou hast indulged our tales long enough for now. She slithers away without further explanation. For she seems reluctant to discuss the circumstances of her past with Wolfed. Yet he senses that she is here by choice. Awake from what little sleep you managed this past night. Once more, the voice tormented you within your dreams. You attempt to rid your memory of it. If the voice truly is that of the Arch Justice Androbelus Knife himself, as Wolfred indicated, then none of you are likely to receive too warm a welcome should you regain your freedom. Here, in the untamed reaches of the downside prayer, you encounter a message imp, come to deliver news and rumors from the other side. The news and rumors, the news this time pertains to Hedwyn, whom you liberated at the fall of Solium. You learn Hedwyn returned safely to the Commonwealth, where he was clothed and welcomed. Past transgressions, all forgiven. But he was to be groomed for a leadership position of his choice, whether on the council or the blood border, each equally as lucrative and secretive as well. However, he refused, and before his town council member could do anything about it, he left them. He's since made contact with Wolfred's agents and is working together with them. Thus, the ranks of the revolution grow stronger. Per the messenger imp custom, the last part of the message was transcribed from Hedwyn, word to word, and says, "Keep going. I'll see you here." You thank the messenger imp for relaying this information. Soon, your companions are all abuzz about it.
May that boy's spirit infect the lord of Yawos with a plague.
Well done, Hedwyn, my boy, I know you could do it.
A glorious example Hedwyn sets for all of us.
Yeah, that's how it's done, Hedwyn. Right behind you, Jam.
Teasel is happy to hear Hedwyn is well back in the Commonwealth. The news of Hedwyn's liberation fills you and your fellow exiles with newfound resolve. Your companions gain hope for the next ride. The Ridge of Gaul. The serpent titan Gandalf turned to brittle stone not long after his death. Of that you may be certain. What remains is a flat, elevated basin that stands as closer to the heavens. Upon the fallen Gandalf's hide, the stars themselves alight, and you shall know you stand on sacred ground. We set the metal sigils, lit the candle flames, and we emblazoned on the rock like forms the sigil of our passage to and from this land. And then the stars themselves, they did reply to us. They sang, shining bright, their voices loud and clear. We understood their cadence, and we knew how often to return.
Hey guys, what are you guys doing all the way back here? You know, it's not so bad here, I was thinking. And I got some pretty good stuff, I think you ought to check it out. Leaving that, just look at how much we got this time.
Downside talismans. So survival often is conflated with the physical. When we think of survival, we assume that the need to sustain our bodies or improve our bodies, the strong survive. And take it from the alpha sheaf. There are different kinds of strength. The spirit is what drives us. By comparison, the body's impulses are weak. Here in the downside, faith is found in limited supply. Trinkets and mere baubles that would barely fetch a price in our homeland, here are talismans. Seek talismans that mean something to you. Hold on to one that you hold dear. It shall reward you with reminders of your faith, your power, your potential. The mood is more dour than usual as you make preparations for the coming ride. A hush has fallen over your fellow exiles, and a sense of dread hangs in the air. At least one of your companions is unfazed.
I sense the influence of one of our own. She is nearby. Her mind corrupted. Calls out, screaming. Can't you hear it, perhaps?
She speaks of Witch Aldmilde, the adversary whom you expect to face this night.
The witch. She doth revere an ancient god and dying, and unyielding on this land and on her consciousness. We may attempt an exorcism here, for the conditions are unique. Sorry, and she may not be expecting us to be abetting here. However, this risk is upon her mind and mine own. Although a worthwhile risk, perhaps.
Bertrude seems to think that old Milda can be weakened somehow through the coming rite. Then the stars above begin to shimmer with their strange light.
The star of Vishlach, our adversary worships it, and whom it represents. Fixate upon that star, reading one, if thou so darest invoke its power. Do so, and our adversary, Eldmilde, she shall be emboldened. I've also left vulnerable to our own sorceries. We may yet limit her ambitions thus.
Richard asks you to invoke the start of Ishlach in this right. Richard Seems right.
Ja, je hebt vertrouwen in ons moor en door presence. Nee, we zijn zo van je mongie. Goh! Bert should lead us forth and gaze at her adversary. Don't maggot, we should have known. But Bertrude does not respond. Ye, night twins, that one shall be of little benefit to ye. That one sorcery is a mere pretense to the overwhelming might of Ishlak. Soon ye shall see. Reading one, don't invoke the star of Ishlak, so then beware. Frua sorceries shall Udmilde be cast into a hopeless doubt about her faith upon her god. Each fate shall be done if we prevail, but only if each our own mind shall perhaps be forfeit otherwise. It seems that through the outcome of this fight, either Udmilde shall be permanently weakened, or Bertrude shall instant. Knight is unafraid of our most terrifying foe, for the most part. And now the night wins. He wished to mock Ishlak? In your infinite foolishness, shall be among the first Ishlak, are thou even listening to us? Dost thou yet live? We believe in thee. Thou must be out there, lest our purpose for existence be for naught. Such pain we shall inflict upon you for this insolence. The scribes cannot protect you, and Russian test shall be
not be for this not or not be not.
How can this be? How can this be? Ishlag, answer us. Ishlag? Ishlag!
Witch Almilde continues with her screaming, having been defeated in the ride. Having observed Bertrude there, fixed in a meditative pose.
Relent. Thy God has not abandoned thee, because thy God is dead. Thy God is dead. Pray to him, although likest, yet it shall do thee no good.
As Bertrude recedes into the shadows, Ulmilda slams down, staring at nothing before her.
Impossible! This cannot be. Answer us!
Ultimild suffered hope permanently. There proves little time for rest at the Black Wagon after your fellow exiles vanquished the withdrawn with great prowess. Those afflicted with banishment sickness seem to be doing better, at least, and express gratitude to Tizo, Loki, and Sir Gilman for their efforts. Just then, the drowned minstrel appears before you. No words escape his lips. You can guess full well what he has come to indicate to you, and throw him back out into the darkness. The stars above seem to be few and fading, and yet one still shines defiant. The path to freedom reveals itself once more. Notice that the lone minstrel is standing there with you, regarding the night sky, the great guardian, and I. We have paid witness to the liberation rites upon the fall of Soldium for a long time. We have seen so much. And so, I'm a bit taken aback, is all, to see something which I have never seen. You look upon the stars together for a while, then I wish for you good fortune and the wisdom of the scribes on your ascent. The lone minstrel leaves you there alone under the night. It has grown very late, and you need rest. The Black Wagon shall have to take flight again come morning. Ishlak Astralborn. The foul name of the Star Titan is written here but once. Not invoke it, lest you aid its reawakening. It saps upon despair and fear and doubt, and lands such as our own. That was our mighty Mistress Milich, which tracked the astral-born monstrosity within its loathsome pit, where it lay nursing wounds sustained from travelling across the stars in search of simple prey. The wicked astral-born could drive a lesser creature to the brink of sanity with a mere passing glance, but not Milith. She cast upon the fiend 100 words of binding, each one more binding than the last. With the creature's incandescent skin, we bound this book and bound ourselves onto the stars. That's it for today. Thank you very much. Bye bye.